probably break about half. We've got a few ghosts in the machine here, so hopefully everything will work out right. Corrine asked me to talk about the blues and its history and how it's influenced American music. Its uniqueness, which I thought was a very interesting request, and I think I'm going to address that a little bit. I think the blues has had, I think it's obvious to say blues has had a profound effect on American music. I'm going to talk a lot about what that effect is and how it's influenced what you hear today in everything from rock and roll to jazz, because it has had a profound effect on all of those things. I want to start, though, by reading a couple of quotes. I know you all can read, but I kind of want to say these things out loud and talk a little bit about it. This is from a book called Jazz, A History by Frank Tiro. And I found Tiro to actually be very on target with a lot of the stuff in the blues. And this is one of a couple of things that he says about it. The blues is a personal statement made in musical terms, which is nevertheless valid for all members of the society. That speaks to me about the fact that blues reaches across all kinds of lines. You connect with people when you're really doing blues, and I think there's a couple of reasons why. The blues can differ in mood, theme, approach, or style of delivery. Blues are not intrinsically pessimistic, even though they often tell of defeat and downheartedness. For in expressing the problems of poverty, migration, family disputes, and oppression, the blues provides a catharsis that enables the participants to return to their environment with resignation, if not optimism. There is an expressive sensuality in the blues that is almost exultant in its affirmation of life, and the music eases the pain, providing an outlet for the frustration, hurt, and anger that blues singers and their audiences feel. In their natural setting, whether rural or urban, blues singers maintain a feeling of kinship with their audience. Their statements describing their own states of mind are generalized by the audience when they recall the same or similar experiences. I really liked this quote. It was a little academic, given the fact that I cut my teeth on the streets. But I think it says a lot of things that are very true about the blues. The blues is not sad music. It's not depressed music. It's often the way for the person performing the blues to get out of that state. It's also a way of beginning to share your experience with other people who've had similar experiences. Not the same experience, but similar. And in fact, as a songwriter, one of the things I know is that when you write lyrics, if you're very, very specific, you know, on Tuesday I went down to the corner store at 12th and Liberty, you're not going to connect with as many people as if you say something a little bit more generically so that people can read their own experiences into it. I think this is one of the essences of certainly a good blues song. We're going to actually examine some of the lyrics. So it's a music that, my first experiences with the blues were feeling good, enjoying the sound of the music. I remember when I was living in Boston, we used to go down to Roxbury and go hear Luther Guitar Jr. Johnson play and just dance all night. It was just a big party, and he just kept it going all the time. So, you know, the blues, it's I think, even has a connection to the African concept of dancing out your frustrations, dancing out your feelings, doing something positive with that energy that turns it back into a positive experience, takes away the negativity. And so it's what they call transmutation. It's taking a kind of feeling and moving it into another kind of feeling. And I think this is why so many people connect with this music. Now I had to do a little research on the history a little bit. I know a lot of things about the blues in terms of its structure, how it's influenced American music, but I had to go back and find out a lot of things about the blues that happened before I was around, which is the late 50s. And so one of the things that I found fascinating was this, the first couple of statements in here about
We just lost our connection. All right. Well, I'm not going to worry about that. I can talk loud. W.C. Handy, finding this person, he called it, and actually I have a couple of different descriptions of this, so I'm not sure if these are really accurate. In this quote, it says a lean, loose-jointed Negro. One of my other quotes had a different version of the same thing. Was a ragged, loose-jointed black. Right. So you get some different descriptions of that. But he said, playing the weirdest music I'd ever heard, playing the guitar with a pocket knife, kind of using it as a slide. And he's just singing over and over again, going where the Southern crossed the dog, which, and by the way, I did research that and found out it's the Southern Railroad crossing the Yazoo Delta Railroad, which they used to call the Yellow Dog. So he's just talking about a junction in Mississippi where he was waiting to go somewhere. It very quickly evolved, I think, in a lot of different ways. Handy, in fact, wrote one of the first pieces, Memphis Blues, that was published. So we see the blues in print for the first time, I think it's 1912. Yeah. 1914, he writes a cut called St. Louis Blues. We're actually going to listen to a version of that very shortly here. Now, the other thing that I found about the blues that I was less familiar with, but knew a little bit about, was the classifications. A lot of historians have organized the blues into different categories. And so you'll see the first header, in fact, across the printout is folk blues, country blues, Delta blues, Southern blues. Now I found all of those things kind of mixed together. And of course this is one of the problems with history, especially about a music like the blues, which began in obscurity and began at a time in the United States where we don't have the kind of documentation. That's actually going to be another factor that I talked about. So we get blues from different places. Country blues, or folk blues, actually evolved into country music. You see that very early connection there. The folk blues sort of also has that connection to folk music. And Delta and Southern are certainly more geographic descriptions of the same thing. Okay, it's right here. Phoneticize a little better. Now, the country blues was probably done a little bit more by male vocalists. We'll hear a little bit of that as we go along. Robert Johnson, certainly Charlie Patton. The classic blues, which happened in about 1915, 1920, started out more with female vocalists. Bessie Smith, Mamie Smith. The first track that I want to listen to, in fact, is a version of St. Louis Blues by Bessie Smith and Louis Armstrong. Before I get into that, I want to point out that blues, you know, we have 1903 as a sort of line of demarcation here. Jazz has a similar obscurity. They both grew up, again, the time before media was really able to record and document a lot of this stuff. So you get Joachim Behrendt describes as a cross-feeding between the two. You have each of these kinds of blues feeding the styles of jazz that would happen. Jazz, of course, goes out of ragtime, goes out of Dixieland, goes into the big band music, and in each phase, there are things from the blues that feed that, and things from that that feed the blues. And so we get this first crossfade. We have a classic blues singer, Bessie Smith, and she's performing with Louis Armstrong, who became one of the fundamental performers in jazz. So there's not this real hard separation between the musics. And this is, of course, one of the places where it's interesting, but it's difficult, maybe, to classify and organize and categorize everything. Let's see if I can get this thing to actually play. We've got some potion machine over here too. It's the house sound.
It's the house sound, the light sound in the back for me. It's the house sound
in the back. Anybody got a seat in the camera? Well, I'll have to wing it a little bit because if we don't have the music, but there's about six or seven tracks that I wanted to play for you. If we can get that working again a little bit later, we'll get It was fascinating to hear. Mamie Smith, or Bessie Smith, I'm sorry, was a person who could sing loud. Now, one of the things that affects American music a lot is the introduction slowly of technology, right? You have the advent of radio. Well, that does something amazing for music. It's a huge factor in jazz, it's a huge factor in the blues, because it's the first way that this music begins to spread. Otherwise, you're talking about somebody living in a certain place, living in Mississippi, and then having to walk or get on a bus or hitchhike or whatever to get to another place to take the sound that they're doing and perform that sound somewhere else. You had traveling bards. That was a big part of the early blues. People would simply wander. Robert Johnson would go from place to place. So it began to cross-feed. But when you begin to have radio, that happens instantaneously. And then you begin to have recordings. Well, OK Records was actually one of the first companies that began to record, and they recorded a lot of the early classic blues. That's kind of where they began. So Bessie Smith begins to record, Mamie Smith begins to record, some of the artists begin to, other artists begin to record. And when these first come out, and this is a big part of our history of the blues, they call these race records. And a friend over here told me a very funny story. She asked her mother why they would record races. Of course, this is a big part of this topic. The United States was, and in some ways still is, divided along racial lines. And so you have this music that's in some ways insulated simply because of that characteristic. You get these people recording this music and putting it out on radio, and people can buy the records. And this is one of the ways that people have access to this music that are not part of the same culture. So OK Records comes along and begins to record these classic artists, and it has success. This stuff sells. They're kind of surprised by it, truthfully. But they're like, okay, oh, great. So they begin to have a category in the record stores called race records. Okay, and that goes on for a little bit. It is one of the ways that begin to push it. So we get downhearted blues. Now Bessie was very interesting in the crossfade with jazz. Played and worked and recorded with artists such as Sidney Bechet, Coleman Hawkins, Don Rivlin, Jack Teagarden, Benny Goodman. These are some of the beginning artists in jazz. Again, very close relationship here. This is not blues over here in this corner and jazz over here in this corner. These two musics really spawned a lot of this. Mississippi John Hurt recorded for OK Records. A lot of these artists were sharecroppers. They're making $1 a week. And all of a sudden, somebody pays them $20 to make a record. Okay, they're going to make a record. And actually, unfortunately, that practice carried on for a long time, not just in blues, but in a lot of styles. You pay the artist a one-time fee for recording the music, and then you go off and make all the money off of that forever. Unfortunately, a lot of early artists were not real smart about what they did and gave away a lot of material that would have helped them, you know, survive and make a better living and all these other things. Now, another thing that begins to happen here, which I find really interesting as a guitarist, is the electric guitar begins to be invented. It kind of comes in stages. You get people experimenting. Les Paul certainly experiments with it. Rickenbacker releases a guitar that was basically a round body with a shaft with the strings on it. And slowly the electric guitar begins to evolve. Well, this is a way of getting the music from being simply folk music, because if you're sitting there with an acoustic guitar and you don't have a lot of amplification, not that many people can hear you. All of a sudden we've got microphones on stage so the singer can be heard. We've got electric guitars and of course electric basses so you can play along with drums. And now we have a very danceable music. One of the things that I wanted to point out too is the early artists, the early blues artists, were playing a lot by themselves. The recordings that we would have listened to here would have been. Do you guys have the sound turned up again? Yeah, just see if you can click the first one there and see if that actually works. Another one. Let's go go back and look. This is the Bessie Smith with Louis Armstrong. This is 23, I think. It already sounds like the blues.
This is considered race music.
This was probably a race record, yes. Yeah, because she was one of the primary artists on OK Records. She sold a lot of it. Stop for us here.
All right. Is that a little bit easier to hear then?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, a couple of things I want to bring sort of to the surface about this. One is slow tempo, right? And in the early blues was associated with this, you know, less energetic kind of feel. A lot of dialogue back and forth between the singer and the trumpet player, between Louis and Bessie. Right? They begin to communicate their ideas back and forth. This is a hallmark of the blues. And we talk about the form, we'll get into the idea that you have a statement of, you know, a lyric, and then you're going to have somebody play a little bit in between that lyric. Then you're going to have another statement, you're going to have somebody play in between. This, in classical music, this is called antiphonal response or antiphonal music. It was typically done in churches. Somebody would sing, and then everybody would sing, or the choir would sing, and then the congregation would sing. And they used to call it field hollers and work songs. It's the same kind of idea. One person would sing, and then everybody would sing a response. You get the same thing in the sound off when you're marching. I won't do the sound offs, but you all know what I'm talking about. And so there's this, it's a conversation. There's a dialogue here. It's not just a presentation. It's something going on between the different performers. The other thing that I think is interesting about this begins to have a blues form, but we're still not quite there yet. I don't want to get too much into the detail, but this has a statement that's like the blues. It has some sections that are different than what we typically know as the blues today, and then it comes back to this. It uses a lot of devices that we still use today. the harmonized bass line turnaround, for example, this kind of thing at the end that gets us back around to the beginning. That sound we heard at the end of that, sort of the stock blues ending, that's still with us today. You go out and hear blues in a club, you're going to hear these same kind of things. Now, the other thing I want to point out here about the recording process is you're basically standing in front of this huge aperture into which the sound was going and being burned right onto the acetate. So you were, you had to be pretty loud. Bessie was known for being able to project. Louis Armstrong obviously could project as a trumpet player. And you don't hear a lot of the band in the background. So even though you know the music's there, you can hear mainly the singer and the trumpet player going back and forth. And the other music is providing harmony and kind of a backdrop for everything. Part of that is the actual recording process. The fact that you can't get as much detail when you've just got a large horn basically taking all the sound in and driving it down. It's a very antique process compared to how we record today. I'd like to get to the second cut, which is, this is by Willie Johnson, and we're still not to the form. This is one of the things I found interesting about this. Let me play this track here. Okay, I see it's on random, isn't it? Notice the slide. Anybody knows what the words are here? I'd love to know. I listened to this about five times. Now, for those listening to the sound of a harmony, notice there's no changes. It's one chord all the way through. Said, that's one chord. He's not making any changes. The form that we know as the blues today isn't there. The feeling of the blues is there, the expressiveness of it. And he was a blues gospel musician. Obviously, he's singing about finding religion, basically. I think we can sort of pull that out of what he was saying. At least that's part of what I got. And that carried on in his music. And actually, gospel music has, again, some elements in it that are generated from the blues. So even that music has picked up some of the inflection and some of the tonality of that. Now we go on, we begin to get a little bit farther along, we start to hear more of what we know as the form. And I think one of the things that happens here, this still happens today, a lot of performers who play solo all the time, play by themselves, don't really have to follow any particular form. If they want to add a couple of extra bars here, if they want to play the chorus twice or play half a chorus again, they can do it because there's nobody else there that they have to worry about. Once you start playing blues in a group, you're all going to have to agree on something. Right? I mean, you can't sort of watch, oh, he's changing, you know, make the changes at the last minute. So there has to be a form. There has to be something that musicians can follow. This next tune kind of demonstrates that a little bit. Let me actually describe it first. Lead Belly, okay. And actually, I read a little bit about Lead Belly in here today. Had kind of a notorious past. He was in prison a lot and, you know, had a few problems, not untypical of the blues. But he begins to have a little bit more of our basic 12-bar form. Begin to tap your foot to this a little bit. You might, you know, a little bit of volume, you might be able to dance to it. It's beginning to get us closer to where we are today. It's hard to hear on this recording here when you're listening to it this way, but there is a bass player playing acoustic bass with him on this track, and that's why he had to have a cyclical form. The bass player had to know what to do. So he's not playing, it sounds like he's playing by himself here, but if you can hear it more close up, you do hear the bass player playing along with him. So a little instrumental section. But still following the same form. Still going to the same harmony, going to the same 12-bar cycle. Now I'm going to go right into the next track here pretty quick, but I want to pause for a second. This is the track by Robert Johnson. I encountered Robert Johnson early on in my study or my fascination with the blues. One of the things I found really interesting about him, he tended to perform a lot by himself, and he would basically take as long as he wanted to say and play what he wanted to play before he got to the next thing. He was playing by himself. He did not have to be beholden to a group of musicians. I believe most of what Robert Johnson recorded was by himself. He was considered primarily a folk blues artist and could basically do what he wanted. So this is a little bit, there's moments of extension. You can hear, he sort of goes to where we might expect the change to happen, and then there's a couple of extra beats, and then it'll change, and then he'll maybe just wait before he starts singing again and just keep the same chord going. So he's free to move and make this form very malleable, again, because he doesn't have anybody playing with him. Robert Johnson was a big influence on a lot of artists that came after. Frank Tiro tried to transcribe some of the phrasing from some of the Robert Johnson, and it was almost impossible to interpret because of, if you try to time it, how he's coming in and going out really is very eclectic.
The crossroads, Clapton and Robert Johnson, are closer.
Well, again, I think you're going to hear the difference between someone playing by themselves and someone having to play in a group. As soon as you've got other musicians around, you have to agree. And so they have to take his poetry, and that's one of the things we're going to talk about, and fit it to a form. The drummer has to know when the breaks are, the bass player has to play with the drummer, everybody has to know when the chords change, if they're playing harmony. He doesn't have to know. He can decide. And it just extends the form in a different way. It's all storytelling, of course, so he told the story the way he wanted to.
Frank, which do you prefer, playing by yourself or playing in a group?
Mostly I prefer playing in a group. I like the interactivity. I like the conversation. I like what happens when everybody is improvising, even if they're just improvising their parts. I've come to enjoy playing solo a lot more since I've gotten fairly comfortable with it. It's kind of like, you know, shooting basketball by yourself or playing basketball with a team. You know, it's more fun to play with a team. Notice the quality of the recordings is a little better, but not that much better yet. Still dealing with a very old recording technology. Hold on, everybody. Now I'm going to kind of come back to the T-Bone Walker cut a little bit later. I have that on another disc. That was written in 1940. The song I'm going to talk about here for a second was written in 1947. Now, later on, I'm going to get a little bit more into my personal experience with the blues. And the first blues influence for me was a band called the Allman Brothers. Well, they have an album called Live at Fillmore, and on Live at Fillmore is a recording of Stormy Monday. That tune was beautiful, brilliant cut. I'm going to play the Allman Brothers cut for you a little bit later, but that didn't get recorded until the 70s, probably. So all these blues songs carry forward a lot, and that's 1947. People are still doing Stormy Monday today. I'd go do it in a jam session because it's a great tune. Now, right about this time, right after that, 1949, this is where Race Records goes away. And of course, you know, a lot of this, I don't want to get too much into the political aspect of this or the social aspect, but of course there's a lot of changes going on. And the races are mixing a little bit more, there's less of this segregation and separation. Obviously it was still going on, but Jerry Wexler comes along. And it was a Billboard magazine, and changes the Race Records to rhythm and blues. Now, R&B is still with us today. You go into the music store, or you look around the record store, there's R&B. That's one of the categories. Not all of rhythm and blues is blues, but it's all danceable, it's all upbeat, it's all groove-oriented. And then you get, right around this time, you get Chess Records, Sun Records, you get the Gibson Guitar Company starting out now, Duane Allman, again, one of my first influences, was a Gibson man, played a Les Paul. Les Paul is one of the inventors of the electric guitar. So all of this is beginning to bring together, again, the sound that we know today as the blues. One of the things I found interesting, too, September 1957, Buddy Guy steps off the train in Chicago, and he was known for his stage antics. And there was actually a reference to Charlie Patton, who also had a lot of stage antics, like playing the guitar behind his back and between his legs. Now, that sounds kind of familiar to those, anybody who's seen Jimi Hendrix or anybody who's seen Chuck Berry. This has a history. So they were entertainers as well as being expressors of music. And Charlie Patton and Buddy Guy, who's still around, still doing concerts, as a matter of fact, they used some of these things that these people were doing very, very early on. I wanted to back up for a minute, too, and see if I can find the reference. Yes, 1946, Arthur Big Boy Crudup records That's All Right. Anybody recognize that title? Okay. That was the song that launched Elvis's career. Okay. And I found this really interesting and the way they referred to it. See if I can find that exactly. Basically, they said that the recording session wasn't going that well, and then he pulled this tune out and did it, and things went great, sounded great. They put the record out, and all of a sudden, you know, a star is born, sort of. Now, so a lot of artists that we might not consider strictly blues artists began with the blues. Eric Clapton, Cream, when we started as a blues band. Led Zeppelin, very early on, was very blues-oriented. The Rolling Stones, we're going to see a reference in there later to the fact that they really started out as a blues band. All these bands that we think of as rock and roll bands really had a blues background. And I might even try to demonstrate this on the guitar later. There's sort of a movement from this feeling that we're getting in the music now, the rhythmic feeling, which is what we call a shuffle. We'll talk a little bit more about that in the form of the structure. It becomes straightened out with Chuck Berry and Johnny B. Goode, and you begin to have different kinds of rhythm and different kinds of feeling in there, but it's still following the same form. And it's spawning a lot of these different styles, and you can take what's called the barrel house, or what I call the barrel house, it's a type of blues rhythm. Again, I'll play this for you later on. Straighten it out, take away a little bit of the movement in it, and all of a sudden you got heavy metal. Not all of a sudden, a few years, but you can really see the movement from what you're hearing now into the rock and roll, into the hard music that we're hearing today. It's a logical step-by-step sequence of progression. The last thing I'm going to play off this track is something a little fun. And again, the recording here is going to be a little bit better. This is Boom Boom. That's John Lee Hooker. My son and I used to sing this all the time. And used to make me run upstairs and play the drums, and it was about three. We'd do this song. This ended up being recorded by Eric Clapton. And this has, by the way, a device called Stop Time in it. So we got a little break. Again, better recording a little bit later. We're hearing the drums, we're hearing the bass. Great blues lyric. Chantilly lights, a little history. No, but I'm back.
And for the instrumental section, they draw in rhythm. End of stop. And we've got a jam. We've got people soloing over the horn. Got some saxophone. Playing rhythm. Notice also the clarity of the voice. Again, the recording technology means we can hear more of what's going on. When you talk like that, you knock me out. Right off my feet. Whoa, 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 whoa. Or talk. Everything. And I get this out of here before the ghosts come back. Now, we begin to get a little bit more present here. This is where we begin to see people that we know. Eric Clapton, Muddy Waters, B.B. King. Notable here in 1969, Muddy Waters and B.B. King perform at the Fillmore East to a predominantly white audience. Now again, this is getting music that's considered black music over into the white audience. There's a couple of factors here that are kind of critical. One is, you've got a bigger pocketbook. There's more white people at this time. There's more people who have jobs, who have better jobs, who have more money. These people can start selling records, and they can start selling more records, and they can perform at places where they have larger audiences. This begins to put money in the pockets of these artists. That's a good thing in many ways. It also could have been a destructive thing for some of them, because if you don't know how to handle that, and it happens to you quickly, and this, of course, still happens today, in every genre of music, it can be very destructive. And so there was a lot of positivity out of that. There was also a lot of destruction out of that. People were able to do things and live lifestyles that maybe they could have imposed a little more discipline. And it is one of the things that I think kind of stereotypes the music a little bit, because you do get these incidences of people all of a sudden having a completely different income stream and a completely different lifestyle. And the same thing happened in rock and roll. I actually have some friends who went through this, who all of a sudden were quote-unquote stars, and everybody was treating them like they're great, and, you know, giving them everything and taking limos to gigs and all this stuff. And when it goes away, it's very hard. It's very destructive. My friend Jamie, who went through this, said he basically fell apart and he didn't know what was happening after. And he became very self-destructive for a long time. And so the taste of success, if it comes at the wrong time in your career, actually has proven to be kind of deadly to a lot of these artists. And I think this is one of the things that happened. It doesn't have to be that way, of course. There, you know, Buddy Guy, like I said, he's still out there performing today. Obviously, he's taking good enough care of himself that he's alive and kicking and, you know, playing great shows. But this money in the pocket thing really does have an influence. You know, the last sort of part of the history thing that I kind of want to talk about here is just how much of this begins to happen and kind of legitimize it. B.B. King records The Thrill Is Gone. He won a Grammy for Best R&B Performance. Okay, so all of a sudden we've got blues at the award shows, R&B at the award shows. We've got a blues foundation. We've got re-releases of these artists. Of course, Stevie Ray Vaughan is very worth mentioning, the more modern rock blues type of artist. Had a short career, but a huge, huge impact. Now, one of the things I know about Stevie Ray Vaughan is that one of his influences was the jazz guitarist Wes Montgomery. Wes Montgomery is one of my first jazz influences. I love Wes. I think he informed so many jazz players, and he informs a lot of blues players. Dwayne Allman and Dickie Betts both cite Wes Montgomery as one of their influences. I've seen guitarists in very, very different styles all go back to Wes. He was a huge influence on a lot of people. And so if you listen to some Stevie Ray, it's highly recommended. You will hear, for example, he will do chord solos.
in some of his playing, which is directly out of Wes. He'll play octaves, which comes directly out of Wes. And then he'll also do a lot of the tricks. There's a great video that I watched of Stevie Ray taking the guitar, swinging the background behind his back, playing it between his legs, doing all kinds of things with it that we talked about, you know, Charlie Patton and Jimi Hendrix and everybody else doing. So a kind of a direct line, although it took a long time to get there. By this time, recording technology is microphones all over the place. You're recording probably at this point on the tape instead of these old Edison rolls or that's actually what Dean Benedetti used to record Charlie Parker on. It's these old rolls. They look like cans, basically. And you had a stylus that went across the can and made the mark of music in there. Dean Benedetti used to hide in the bathrooms and cut a hole with a sawzall through the wall and stick his microphone in there and only record Charlie Parker. But recording and the media and the ability to communicate this music and to document it by recording it, it's a huge factor, not only in getting the music out there, but in having other artists learn it. This is, where do you think, you know, Eric Clapton learned Crossroads from? A record. You know, right, he bought the record, and, you know, we talked earlier about using the term record as opposed to CD. They went out and they bought the music and they listened to it. I learned my first guitar solos from Duane Allman by taking the record, and I still have the record, and just putting it on this big old turntable that I had with an arm that weighed about 50 pounds, and you'd hear the vinyl being scraped off of it, and I learned the solo by just doing a needle drop, putting it down, figuring it out, taking it off, figuring out what he was doing, putting it back down. That track on that record is actually a different color than the rest of the, I'm not kidding either, and I have a couple of those. I have my first Wes Montgomery solo that I transcribed, it was the same way. I had to do it with a record player, and it literally is a different color because the vinyl peeled away from doing it. Now what I do is I put it on a CD, obviously, and the CD doesn't get destroyed. But that ability to go and sit there and listen to the record and learn those solos, that's how I learned how to play. I started listening to Duane Allman and just, I love this guy's sound, what's he doing? And I just sat there and tried to figure it out. That's what these people were doing. That's a huge change from having to read the sheet music or go take a lesson from somebody and have them teach you what they were doing or have to go to the club night after night after night to hear what the artists were doing. Now you can sit at home with your record player and in a couple weeks you can have it down. This speeds up kind of what I'm going to call the street music education phenomenally quickly. In other words, I don't have to go to school to learn this. I can go get the record, and I can sit down and I can learn it. This, by the way, still happens today, but obviously again with CDs. Every band that I was ever in when I was in high school and college, you didn't get the sheet music. You said, here's the tape of next week's songs. And you went home, and you listened to it, and you learned it from the recording. This becomes the normal procedure now for most, for pretty much all rock and roll bands, and most bands. The only people that really spend a lot of time maybe reading music, but we also listen a lot, are jazz artists because we have something called a lead sheet, so we can just look at the basic form of the tune and play from there. But technology had a huge influence on how this music was pervaded, was spread about, and the instruments that played it, and the ability to hear the detail. I think that's one of the things that's so noticeable. You listen to that first Bessie Smith, Louis Armstrong recording, the only thing you can hear is the voice and the trumpet. You don't hear the detail. By the time we're listening to Boom Boom, you're hearing everything. You're hearing the bass. You're hearing the drums. You're hearing the horn in the background playing a little bit. You're hearing the details of the guitar. Now, I want to point out something about the feel here, and then we're going to take a break relatively soon. All those tracks that I just played were in a type of feel that we call a shuffle. It's kind of a bouncy, I'm going to demonstrate a little bit on here. This is actually one of the first things I teach my students. It's a type of rhythm called barrel house, and it's in this shuffle.